stuff seems very logical to me in its completely crazy, illogical way. It never seemed like a puzzle which one needs to solve. I admire Mahler's skill in opening or starting a symphony, because each start has something extraordinary.
In September 2015, we met composer and director Iván Fischer in his birthplace Budapest, where he worked with his Budapest Festival Orchestra on the recording of Mahler's Obsonate Seventh. A conversation about the eclectic Mahler, the fate of the double role of director and composer, and the Hungarian's national character.
The Seventh Symphony has a rhythm. And this rhythm is this ti, 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 ti. It's strange. I mean, I read many things like Mahler had a funny walk, you know, when he walked and you were talking to him, you couldn't easily do that because he had irregular steps, so one fast and slow, and then a fast step, and again a slow, and then again fast. So when you were talking to him, you could do two things. Either you did the same crazy walk, what he did, and then you were standing next to him, or you were constantly behind or ahead of him and you couldn't talk to him. So there is something about these Mahler's basic rhythms which somehow connect in my mind. It the works are connected with these anecdotes I hear about him. I worked on the other Mahler symphonies a lot, except the eights, which I don't do, but a lot of first, fourth, second, third, sixth. And then the seventh, I was probably a little worried or afraid because everybody said that this is a problem piece. I looked very carefully at the fifth movement, and I think it is absolutely Mahler at his most happy, fantastically liberated, joyous mood. If I have any ambition, then it's the last movement, because generally the middle movements are somehow understood by people, all the night music and the fantastic scherzo, but a lot of people discuss the last movement, and I really want to make a recording which makes it clear to people what it means.
Ez a nyolcadoknak a menetelése, én Azt gondolom, hogy itt ez nagyon extrém hangsúlyosra kéne játszani. We should play it very accented every note.
Szóval jön az üsdob, hogy...
Valami, de legyen több karakter benne. Lot of character in it. Szóval ez az amatőröknek az öröme. Az a mesterdalnokokban is ez van, hogy egész nap bérel számoló, egész héten és vasárnap zenélhet. Ez ilyen legyen. Hát, hogy öröm szó. Na, mert jam, pam, és... Kezdjük kicsit erősebben. Szóval subito forte, hogy legyen ilyen óriási, ilyen extatikus amatőrség benne. 2, 3 Ez az!
You have a bit of Meistersinger, obviously. Now, he was a great admirer of Wagner, and the Meistersinger, especially the overture, but the whole opera, has something which I find very sympathetic, actually, that these people, they have a job. All week, a shoemaker, or whatever job you do, Sundays they make music. And this is the classical amateur. And there is a great joy in this, that Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday I have to do my shoemaking, but now music. And then it goes to the next type of joy.
Első kürtbe, a kürt és a fuvola és az the English horn, the flute and the horn played first is ezt. És I think it should be very strongly accented. Then one gets this kind of joyous yes, yes, yeah. Ez nagyon jöjjön. So as strong as possible. Now let's do 2:30.
In Jewish families, people sing usually after the Sabbath. There's a big lunch. Lunch finished, the whole family or friends sit together, and somebody starts to sing. It's called a nigun. A nigun is a simple melody which doesn't have much text, sometimes nothing, but it's happy. And this complete ecstatic happiness is in these niguns, and then I immediately hear it in Mahler's music when he goes
Na, megpróbáljuk felvenni. Let's try to record this. Hein, can we start now?
Jared is coming up to fix something.
All recordings that Iván Fischer has made with the Budapest Festival Orchestra have been produced and recorded for years by Jared Sachs and Hein Decker. It's a close-knit cooperation based on the love of music and the correct interpretation of it.
Recording is a documentation. We record in order to keep something. It's like making a photograph of yourself or somebody else. This is it. You can look at it for the next years or decades. Now, why we do recordings is an important question to me. Because especially works like Mahler's symphonies, which have been recorded over and over many times, certainly I'm not interested in making the next recording in order to somehow compete with others or to have a personal success. This is not the point. But sometimes, and especially now in the Seventh Symphony, this is the case, there is a work which has a reputation that it's problematic, and I want to prove that it's a great work. There is one passage which sounds to me almost like a courtly early music dance, like a suddenly we go back to a baroque or a fake baroque minuet.
Yes, yes.
I mean, it's all kinds of things, but somehow variety of sounds, and I don't know how of course it can be put into practice, but I imagine like an incredible procession, like various groups would come after each other, and one is like this and the other one like that and the third one is like that, extremely different
and crazy. I mean,
yes, but also logical somehow.
I hear something like it should sound like a 17th or 18th century courtly dance, like an aristocratic little menuet, like something. Let's just do it. It's very elegantly. And also the oboes.
There is the yodel, this there's this kind of Austrian folklore. And you hear it, I mean, unmistakably in this movement where it's puiti, tuiti, tum duiti, tiri, tiri, duiti, tiri. And there's this, he uses words like this, gesellig, behaglich, very kind of comfortable, good, familiar feeling of being Austrian. I think in Mahler's mind there was no conflict of feeling German with Wagner, Austrian with this kind of Tiroler yodel music, or Jewish. The question to me is, does one need to be original as a composer? One needs to be honest, I think. Probably understanding Mahler helped me to write music, because Mahler is often criticized that his music is eclectic, that he took ideas from other composers, that he throws everything together from cowbells and military marches to various musical styles. Eclectic. And when I started to compose, I completely understood why he's eclectic, because all these ideas are whirling around in his mind. Maybe they go a little bit deeper, but when he composes, these ideas pop up continuously. I can imagine that somebody completely pushes it away, that I'm not going to do it, I'm going to compose original music. But would that be honest? It's not honest. So Mahler chose to be honest and allow this surge of ideas which were in his mind to influence his music.
Iván Fischer grew up on the Andrássy út, a stately avenue which we can place back into Mahler's 19th century with ease. Ivan's father translated operas into Hungarian. Their house was opposite the opera house, where Mahler worked as a director for some years. But it is not only the opera that connects Mahler and Fischer. The histories of the Jewish Fischer family and the Mahler family have many points of resemblance.
So this is the old apartment where my parents lived. Mm-hmm. But after they died, I thought, what shall I do with it? So I turned it into a theater. There are public theater performances here. And when the audience comes, they are on this narrow hall here, and they can look at family photos, because then they know where they are. Here, there is the only surviving photo of my great-grandfather, Felix Fischer. He was a merchant in a small town in northern Hungary, and he led a completely religious Jewish life. And his son, my grandfather, stepped out of the religion, went to Vienna to study in the university. And since then, like, my father had no religious upbringing at all. It's exactly what Mahler's family did, stepping out of the Jewish past and living a secular lifestyle. However, of course, my father was considered Jewish, and in the Nazi period, he had to create these documents. These are forged documents, as nothing is true. It's about a Christian birth certificate, and somehow this was done, and he could show it to the police, and then that's how he survived hiding in Budapest. And later he worked in the opera, which is opposite here. You can see his name. He translated Don Pasquale in 1949. This is the poster, and he lived here in this apartment until being 95 years old. Well, from this sleeping room where we slept, we could see the opera very clearly. I had no idea what an opera is all about, but I knew exactly the lengths of each opera, because I saw when people came out in the evening. So we knew that, you know, Otello is exactly 2 hours, Magic Flute over 3 hours, and then they switched off the lights, so we knew the lengths of the operas.
Did you already have fantasies when you were here and looking at the opera?
Well, we lived with it. This was an important thing. For example, when I was 8, my first birthday present was a subscription to the opera. And then my parents told the stories. My father played the main themes on the piano to prepare my brother, my sister, and me. So when we went to the performance, we were very well prepared. We were like critics. I remember I had a small diary, and I wrote in, "Ah, this tenor was terrible, and why did he take this slow speed to this aria?" So it was great fun.
Well, you slept here with your brother?
Yes.
It was the boys' room?
Yes, this was the room where we slept.
And he became also a conductor?
Yes.
How come in one family, 2 conductors?
Well, it was in the air, you know, the opera here and this family completely absorbed in culture and music, and there were discussions at the dining table about why Furtwängler slowed down here and Klemperer didn't. This was a main issue.
So this was your place?
May have been. We were sitting in one of these boxes when I was 8, 9, 10, and I listened to these opera performances. It was great fun, actually.
Can you recall one opera that made a really impression on you?
Well, I remember, well, of course, the Magic Flute may have been the very first one, because my parents made a clear plan of which opera is suitable for the children. So, and then we went through first probably the Mozart operas, then a few Rossini comedies. I remember Elisir d'Amore, a lot of operas which I listened here. This is where I really had my first musical experiences.
So in 1888, Mahler came to Budapest.
Yes. This opera building was relatively new, a few years old, and I think people wanted to have an international, very ambitious leader, and they heard about Mahler. Mahler was 28 and he came to this building and he became the director. And he started to work here with an incredible ambition, like everything was had to be wonderful and perfect, and was of course huge resistance because this company wasn't used to that. They had a comfortable life. Nobody ever challenged them, and Mahler did. So there are many stories about the resistance against Mahler.
Because the theater was rather new, eh, when he came.
Yes, it was new, and there wasn't really a tradition of quality here before Mahler.
So what did he bring here?
Well, he performed a lot of things, Wagner, a lot of new operas, old operas, Mozart, and great quality. And of course, he was immediately accused that he's not Hungarian, foreigner, that he was Jewish. Why do we need this Jewish foreigner here? There were nationalists all over the place. And for those people, Mahler was a problem.
Because he signed a contract for, I mean, I think 10 years, and he stayed just 2-3 years?
Yes, but there was almost like a war going on in this house. There is the famous story that there was a choir member who actually challenged Mahler to a duel because...
Pistols?
Yes, or whatever, you know, he sent his assistants that I want to have a fight with you, a duel, because... apparently Mahler insulted him in a rehearsal. And Mahler wrote a very correct letter back to him saying that I cannot do this because you challenge me as a person, but when I criticize your singing, I did it in the position of a conductor and an opera director, so I cannot have a pistol fight with you. Mm-hmm. But it was still typical for the situation in Hungary which received Mahler.
What still remains of Mahler here in Budapest?
Well, very little. You know, yeah. He was here for a short period of time, then he left, he went on, and he was probably forgotten a little bit. And for many, many years, especially as a composer, his works were not performed, although his first symphony was first performed in Budapest, with the orchestra working in this building. And much later, probably after the Viennese rediscovered Mahler in the 60s, 70s, especially when Leonard Bernstein made a big mission to make Mahler again accepted in Vienna, and gradually it came to Hungary too. I did really my best to perform Mahler already decades ago, and still I had to read little articles about, well, problematic composer. There was still a little bit of doubt. But now Mahler is extremely popular. Everybody loves his music. Mahler's problem was that he was a celebrated conductor. He was the best conductor of his time. But actually, deep down, he wanted to be a composer. He thought that he was an important composer. Nobody acknowledged it. And he had to fight to push this through, that he's seen as a composer and not a celebrated conductor. I can deeply understand that.
You have your own orchestra. Was it ever a dream or came up for you to have your own opera company? Or
it's interesting. Maybe I should have worked in opera because I feel very close to opera and now I'm also staging operas. But somehow, I don't know how life led me to another direction, but actually to work in opera continuously is a wonderful dream, but somehow it developed in a different way.
Hello.
when I started to compose, and I noticed immediately the things like, yes, it's true, different styles come to my mind, and knowing Mahler's story helped me, because there was this great composer who allowed the eclectic composition and didn't try to be original for originality's sake. So that gave me a kind of liberated feeling that there is nothing wrong in allowing yourself to be eclectic. And when I write music, I went very far in it. I actually use a kind of collage system that these different styles clash with each other. A little bit like those visual artists who take a frame, and in the frame you find an old key, a leaf, a burnt paper, a little painted surface somewhere. So there are these collage artists visually. So why not collage music? And what I also enjoy that it's completely understood by the audiences, because the audiences are also living in this mixture. You hear music all the time. Music comes to you from the radio, from the ringtone of the mobile phone or whatever. Music comes from everywhere, and we live in this eclectic world. So actually, this eclectic music language is the language of our age.
Iván Fischer wrote the opera The Red Heifer. It's about a 19th century court case, the Tisza-Esla affair, in which Jewish villagers were accused of the ritual murder of a young Hungarian girl. The crown witness in this case was a 13-year-old boy who accused his father of murder. His testimony turned out to be false.
I'm not sure if I would call The Red Heifer a political opera. Maybe it reflects to important questions which are important for our society today, but they are more reflecting on my contact to Hungary, my contact to the Jewish origin, and the problems of stepping out of the Jewish religion.
First, Marek Scharf said his father was innocent. But because of the shrewd manipulation and indoctrination by a court clerk, he was like putty in the hands of the Justice Department.
Cserép tálba ereszte templomban jelen voltak, Lustig Samuel Braun Ábris, Weisstein Lázár és Juncker Ábrahám.
Szomosi Eszterek minden a pápa szabad a tömben a házuba bejött, kapott az fehér eskendő a fején, vörös eskendő a nyakán, fehéres forma vizitkes valami kékes szoknya.
Bis, 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 egy korunk!
Ott a templom udvarában a magasban lakodó zsidó a lábát ragadta és a földet terítette. Ekkor kezdett talán nyagadni és ordítani, de ekkor hirtelen a tarcani téglási mercek a leállt a földbe, megmondta.
Mis, mis, mis itt vagyunk! Mis, mis, mis itt vagyunk!
The interesting thing for me was, how can a 13-year-old Jewish boy be pushed in this role of standing up and saying, you, my father, you are a murderer, which was obviously crazy, it wasn't true. And after he did that, and the people were acquitted because there was no other proof, he had to go back to his family and keep the Jewish life, the family life, after being a traitor. How to come to terms with it, how to come back, how to understand what happened to you when you were 13, 14 year old. But in this boy, maybe there is a little more. It's us, it's the whole generation of Jewish people who stepped out of the religion, maybe betrayed their ancestors, mm-hmm. and started a new life because they were so obsessed and enchanted by the other world. And this world surrounds us too, and probably it also surrounded Mahler, who also stepped out of the Jewish religion and became carried away by the non-Jewish lifestyle. A lot of people wrote about that I wrote something which is critical about the Hungarian society today. All right, it is true, but it's critical not about the present political problems, but about something which is an illness in the Hungarian society for more than 150 years.
Hungary has a huge disease, nationalism, that they are so deeply, fanatically nationalistic that they don't realize what they do to other people. They played a terrible part in the Holocaust. They behave terribly now against foreigners, immigrants, anybody. It's a big, big problem in Hungary.
I always imagined that there was this generation of Kurt Weill and Brecht, and they created a new style of music theater, and then the war came, it was cut. And after the war it didn't continue. And it was a fantastic thing, this a number of things. First of all, that the musical style created by Weill, these simple songs, and the musical language which is understood by people, and original and fast and witty and a lot of sense of humor, and also very, sometimes very tough and rough ideas. Now, the other thing was that it was political theater, that it wanted to address things which were important to the society, to the people. And this idea fascinates me, that actually the Second World War and the Holocaust and everything, the whole Nazi time, cut off a very important development in opera, which should continue, I think. And now, even after a break of 60, 70 years, I feel a little a responsibility to write these small operas which continue the tradition of the Brecht theater.
German writers from the pre-war period also play an important part in Ivan Fischer's life. A manuscript by Thomas Mann ended up with his family.
It came from a visit of Thomas Mann. Thomas Mann visited Hungary in the 30s. He was working on the Josef und sein Brüder, on this book. And he met a Hungarian translator called Sárközi, who was ready to translate it into Hungarian. So Thomas Mann gave him a manuscript. Now, is it the manuscript or one of them? Maybe there were a few copies, or maybe it was written by a copyist. I don't know. He gave it to this man. And this young Hungarian writer then died in a camp in the Holocaust. He was a good friend of my father. And when he was taken away, he said to my father, "Can I give you this typewritten manuscript by Thomas Mann? Please look after it. It has to be safe. And when I return, please give it back to me." But he never returned. And my father always had it in a box, and then I inherited it from him. Now, should I give it to maybe a Thomas Mann Institute? I don't know, but I always think this man said that we should keep it until he returns, so we keep it.
What does it mean to you to have this?
I don't know. If I would give it to, I can show it to experts, but I would hate the idea to give it away, because there was this clear instruction from this man of please keep it. It's like, I don't know, like holding on to a generation, mm-hmm. I think.
Psst, 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 psst. Andant az érgem eszmélyetek. Ne zajongjatok, egy picit könnyebb lesz akkor. Kicsit lehet erősebb hangsúly. Tehát a hangsúlya, a játékosabb. Jó, most nagyon jó. Na, itt vigyáznak, ne menjen szét. Várjatok! Ne nyivákoljanak a hegedük most picit. Az, van egy kis rubátó. És az, hogy a kettő egy picit jöhet később, hogy poj, tiatara, tara. És ez elromlik akkor, amikor félhangról csúszik a brácsa cselló, mert akkor egy kicsit tovább kéne várni. Tehát ez a diatta,
titta. When I see you working with the orchestra, is it true that you want to be in control of everything?
Of course, yes, I think so, because I want to, I hear something inside and I want to hear what I hear, so, and probably that's the only way which makes the musicians happy. If I try to be half honest about it, like, okay, you play differently, but it's not exactly what I would like to hear, but I understand, I expect it, and I accept it, then there is this continuous compromise. I don't think it works. I think good conductors hear something inside, and very often they don't even need to say anything. It's so obvious what they want to hear, movements or expression or facial expression, occasional one remark, and then the orchestra is happy. Then they say, oh, he knows what he wants to hear, and we do that. So being in control of every musical detail
is, I think, the most natural thing for any conductor. It has nothing to do with dictatorship. You can be the most democratic and human conductor and still have a complete image of the music you want to hear.
The Budapest Festival Orchestra is a dream. It's probably a dream of any conductor. I'm very fortunate because I could found my own orchestra. I could develop the whole philosophy, the working system, the methods, the rules of the orchestra, which are slightly different than the conventional symphony orchestras. I work with other orchestras occasionally, but nothing comes near the Budapest Festival Orchestra, because here I can achieve musical results which are far beyond that of other orchestras. To have a symphony orchestra of artists who are creative, who take initiative, even of course they have to be a completely disciplined team, and I have to lead them, but I always ask their emotional input, and they are very happy to provide it. So it's an orchestra of involved artists.
It's okay, you didn't do anything, it's all right. Teljes hangom. Oké, okay, nagyon köszönöm mindenkinek, és jó utazást! Köszönöm szépen, bravo! Ja, próba van.
Igen, próba van.